So today, I had not planned to speak. Today's Community Sunday. So my objective is merely to create a frame or framework and then to invite each of you as you feel called to come here, just so you know there are two chairs. And the reason for that is that so we have a smooth transition between speakers. When you feel called to share, you can just sit and wait as the other person is sharing. So today we open a 5-week sermon series or lesson series on Parker Palmer's book, A Hidden Wholeness, as said here. The focus of today is this idea of rejoining soul with role. And as I reflect upon that for myself, I remember that early on in our relationship, my husband, Victor, paid me what I thought was probably the biggest compliment that I had ever gotten in my life. It wasn't, oh, you're so pretty. It wasn't, oh, you're so smart, or you're so good at what you do. Rather, what he said that actually kind of stunned me was that he commended me for my commitment to waking up, to knowing my own soul, to waking up to spirit and to oneness. And as I reflected on that, I definitely took it into my heart as a huge compliment. But right after that, I started thinking about all the ways in my life where I deviated from my soul. And so I reflected on how I, for the first 30 years of my life, without even consciously realizing it, was immersed in addiction, for instance. I looked at how, wow, you know, even though a part of me, since I was a little girl, I remember walking down my neighborhood telling my friends, I don't understand why there's hunger and poverty in the world, and when I grow up, I'm gonna fix that. You know, that there was this service orientation from the beginning, like on a worldly scale. And then I found myself sitting there in my 20s and 30s at the top of a high-rise in San Francisco practicing corporate law, corporate litigation. And I wondered, like, what had happened, you know, that pulled me from that sense of who I am and what I want to do in the world. And when I reflected back, I realized that what pulled me from, like, this core sense of knowing of who I was wasn't one big thing. It was a series of little decisions I made every single day. The moment when my mom or dad would light up at the prospect of any of their kids becoming a doctor or a lawyer. There were no other options in our family that would be approved of, right? There wasn't an idea that you would actually be something like a musician or a poet, something creative like that. That wasn't in the framework of what seemed permissible. And so, little by little, as I stepped out into the world as a little girl, and I put forth what I thought I wanted, and people would either smile at it or frown at it, I realized that I made these decisions that pulled me from myself to the point where, in my 30s, if you asked me what I really wanted, I couldn't even decide to change my job as a lawyer because I was so distant from who I was, my soul, that I had to keep following what other people wanted because I didn't know what I wanted by that time. And so it's with that framework that I opened Parker Palmer's book just this past December. And I read this story in the preface. And I'll read the story here verbatim for you, because I think the way he's a beautiful writer, and I'd love to share his exact words with you, and invite you to consider this story for yourself. And then I'll invite you to come up and share about it. He opens with a quote by Leonard Cohen. My research tells me that it was Daniel Whitford who actually wrote the lyrics to this song. But Leonard Cohen is famous for these lyrics. "The blizzard of the world has crossed the threshold, and it has overturned the order of the soul." And then writes Parker Palmer, "There was a time when farmers on the Great Plains, at the first sign of a blizzard, would run a rope from the back door out to the barn. They all knew stories of people who had wandered off and been frozen to death, having lost sight of home in a whiteout while still in their own backyards." Imagine. They're still home, but they're lost. And so he writes, "Today we live in a blizzard of another sort. It swirls around us as economic injustice, ecological ruin, physical and spiritual violence, and their inevitable outcome, war. It swirls within us as fear and frenzy, greed and deceit, and indifference to the suffering of others. We all know stories of people who have wandered off into this madness and been separated from their own souls, losing their moral bearings and even their mortal lives. They make headlines because they take so many innocents down with them. The lost ones," he says, "come from every walk of life, clergy and corporate executives, politicians and people on the street, celebrities and school children. Some of us fear that we or those we love will become lost in the storm. Some are lost at this moment and are trying to find the way home. Some are lost without knowing it. And some are using the blizzard as cover while cynically exploiting its chaos for private gain. So it is easy to believe the poet's claim that the blizzard of the world has overturned the order of the soul. Easy to believe that the soul, that life-giving core of the human self with its hunger for truth and justice, love and forgiveness, has lost all power to guide our lives. But," Parker Palmer shares in his book something I so agree with, "Parker's experience of the blizzard, which he admits includes getting lost in it more often than he likes to have admitted, tells him that this is not so. He says the soul's order can never be destroyed. It may be obscured. We may forget or deny that its guidance is close at hand. And yet we are still in the soul's backyard, with chance after chance to regain our bearings. So the journey that I'm inviting all of us to in these upcoming weeks, whether at Unite or whether you'll be taking the class with us on Tuesdays, is about tying a rope from the back door out to the barn so we can find our way home again." That's from Parker Palmer's perspective. I want to share that from a profound unity perspective, there is a recognition that we have always had the rope with us, right? But in the chaos, in the sense of forgetfulness and lostness of this foggy scene, when we are in the blizzard. I remember when I heard Victor open up with his song about waking up, you know, "Wake Me Up." And it says, wake me up when it's all over. And I so identified with that sentiment. I feel like most of us are just like, whatever chaos is going on, just wake me up when it's over. And I realized, okay, yeah, our path is to wake up in the middle of the blizzard. And when we wake up, we recognize that we have always carried this rope, this way of knowingness to our home. That perhaps actually our home is connected to us and it's meant to be brought forth into the blizzard of the world. I invite you to consider that. But it's of no help to the world when we are out there lost and scrambling. And those of us who study the Enneagram know that each of us in our personality types being lost in the blizzard responds in a different way. Some of us are frantically trying to get everyone to just do something, right? Like if we just do enough and run around active enough, we will fix this situation, right? Others of us think if we just back off and be quiet, you know, it's going to work itself out. You know, and so we all have different reactions. But the idea behind this book and this invitation is that what if the world needs us to be this light, to first wake up to the light that is already within us, and then automatically we don't have to try to shine that light into the world. The light doesn't happen. It doesn't come from our fragmented self. It doesn't come from the self that I think I'm supposed to bring forth here. Imagine when you come up here, who's standing here before everyone? Is it really you? You know, I was sitting there thinking, you know, what parts of me are fully alive here? And what parts do I squash? What don't I fully bring? And I thought this was funny. I think parts of me that I hide include my sense of humor. You know, it's funny because there are people where they're blatantly humorous. And I realized that those ways of being for me were really censored. Like a sort of spontaneous way, and that's starting to come out. But interestingly enough, like that natural part of me that's more alive at home when I'm safe and comfortable are not as alive in the world. So one clue for you is when you feel deeply safe, what comes out? And so I want to close this time of sharing by simply inviting you up here either to respond to the story in any way that you feel called or to answer that question. When you feel safe, what aspect of you comes out? How can that be brought forward more in your community life for the world? With that, I'll open our time of sharing. The mic's up here.
I guess when I'm alone and feel most comfortable, I'm not afraid to be vulnerable. And my close friends know that about me. I cry at cartoon movies. And perhaps I can bring more of that. My public self. It's interesting. I'm up here every week in front of you people, and maybe I don't know you as well as I could, and that's another thing. I'm perhaps a little more private than I could be. I get in my head. There's a lot going on in my world, as I'm sure every one of you. So, I'm doing my best to open up and accept what the world has and be present, really, at the White Stone Ceremony. This year I wrote Awake because I want to be in the moment, and if my girls are all consuming or a relationship I'm thinking about is all consuming, I can't be as present. So I'm trying to be a little more present with all of you and more open. Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
Is this on?
Yes, it is.
Good morning.
Hi, John.
I'm John. So as I consider this last question about the question I get up in the morning asking myself, that question consistently is, who am I? And I spent most of my life not asking that question. I spent most of my life setting aside initial dreams that I had and doing jobs for the money that they would bring to support my family. And once Maka and I were together, I began to pick up a thread again that had been important to me early in life. I started writing poetry when I was about 14 and was introduced really to a wider perspective of the world that way. My grandparents used to occasionally drag me to a Baptist church that I was pretty sure was not my path. And so I pursued courses in school like the Bible as literature, Western mysticism, and so forth. But again, when opportunities came along just to earn enough cash that I could eventually retire, that's the option I would consistently choose. Just like my dad did, he would, he started off with the Kansas City Southern Railway as a brakeman, and then an engineer, and then a train master, and a superintendent when he retired at age 62, but he was just so burned out from the stress of it, along with some past regrets that he was carrying around. And I so wanted to reject my dad and the things that made life difficult between us that I vowed, you know, first of all, I started off my work career as a brakeman and conductor over the road. I did that for 5 years. I helped pay my way through college. And then at one time I was, in 1996, up in northern Maine, I had been general manager of the second largest employer in the area for 17 years. In the last 3 years I was there, I was senior vice president with responsibility for 5 offices around the United States, a couple thousand employees. And I just imploded. I'd gone through a divorce. The job was partly responsible for that. And it took everything I had to persevere through that. And then when I got back to Kansas City and finally retired from the telecom, I had pursued a similar course again, trying to go up the ladder to the point of ultimate stress, which I found again. And that's just the way my life proceeded. I was semi-aware that there was more to life than that. But to make a long story short, like my dad, I decided to retire early, but I had a very definite purpose in mind, and that was to pursue what was really important, what was meaningful to my soul. And so that was about 5 years ago that I retired, and I set about to exercise, read everything I could of a spiritual nature, and was just kind of casting around looking for what I eventually found in this community. I didn't think anything Sometimes the appreciation for this just brings me to tears. So I didn't think anything like this existed, and that there would be nowhere that I could just show up as I was and be helped in so many ways to find myself, my true self. So that's been my journey. I'm just so very thankful for everything that led me to this point. And that's what I have to share. Thank you.
Thank you, John.
Hello, I'm Jenny. And like several people have said already, well, to answer Nan's question, what is my question? What gets me up in the morning? If I'm really honest with myself, I get up in the morning and my question is, what can I do so that I don't have to think about what that question should be? I'm really good at that. And I've known for several years now that that question, when I let myself think about it, is like John's, who am I? Who am I really? And I think that is because for a really, really long time, you know, 55, 57 years, I always thought my question was, who do I need to be? Who does that person see me as? Who do my children need me to be? Who does my husband think I am? Oh, that girl's really cool, I want to be her friend. Who do I need to be her friend? And I've run away from who I really thinking about who I am. And so when I let myself ask, who am I? I find it very difficult to sit and even ponder the question.
Thank you, Jenny.
Thank you.
Everybody, I'm Steve.
Hi, Steve.
Hi, Steve.
This is my first time here in about a month, and I don't know really what I want to say, but I do want to say a couple things. My youngest son passed away 2 years ago, and that was what brought me back to Unity. We had the service here, and Duke did a great job. And some days I would just sit. I also attend other meetings here, and some days I just sit in the sanctuary and find the peace in the quiet in there. And as mentioned earlier, the beauty from the stained glass windows, and it helped me through those hard times. And I think, you know, what I've got lost in the blizzard here lately. I miss my spiritual support group, the people that feed me the things that I don't get fed by other people in my life. And I was very fortunate to come in a little early, and I got to talk to Robert and express my admiration and gratitude for the lessons he shared. And I want to thank Nian too. One of the first things I learned about Nian, one of my first questions to her was, what was her calling like? Because I knew she had a calling. And those are the things that I've had that happen to a good friend of mine that I grew up with. He had a calling, and my attorney at one point had a calling and then became a minister. And so people have had experiences that drew them to their true nature. And I always had that curiosity of what that looks like, because I've always had a yearning. I grew up in a small town, old-timey Methodist church, which was, if you watch the movie, The River Runs Through It, the minister there describes a Methodist as a Baptist who could read. And he was a fire and brimstone, and I was always looking for that loving God that I heard people talk about, but it was also the punishing God that was going to rain fire and hell down upon me for things I was not only was thinking or doing, but as my Catholic friend said, the things that I was thinking. And I thought, I've already screwed the pooch, I might as well just kind of go down in flames. But I always, even during those times, I always had that yearning about the spiritual part of life. And back in the old days, I'm going to say, the early to mid 70s, I like to listen to the radio, and sometimes the AM preachers would, I gravitate towards listening to them because they had a message, I just didn't know what that message was, so I'd listen to them, and then inevitably every one of them had a tipping point that I said, I can't believe in that, because a lot of it was bigotry and ignorance. And here in Unity, I found open-mindedness lately, I've just been, like I said, I've been lost in the blizzard, and I want to find my way back, and that's why I'm here today. I miss this. I miss the thoughts of oneness. I was also drawn to that picture that's on the, I found that quite fascinating. Not only is it the image of the bridge itself, but the reflection of its water, and I thought that's kind of symbolic of who we are. We have this, who we really are, and this reflection of what we cast out into the world. And sometimes they're not the same thing. And for me, it's, like I said, I come here for the authentic self that I can't always feel safe expressing out there. You asked the question, what do I do, how do I act when I feel safe? And one of the things I do is sing, and I'm not going to do that now, because I don't feel that safe. I feel safe enough to share that. And the other thing is, I recently retired in the last couple of years, and the thing that I enjoy, my passion is photography, and that photograph is a good example of what that brings out in me, of capturing this beautiful life that God has given us, and then being able to share that with other people. It took me years to be able to get up the courage to just post my own pictures on my own walls, because I was very judgmental about my own work. It took a while for me to just say, to be able to say, this is who I am, this is what I've done, and just have people accept me for who I am instead of who I want them to think I am. So for me, it's been it's a lesson, a long lesson, and I appreciate the things that I've learned in Unity by people like Robert and Mian and Love Victor's music and Mark. It's always good to see you. And it's the people that I've been really missing lately. So I'm really glad to be here, to be a part of this. That's it.
Thank you, Steve. Thank you.
Welcome back, Steve.
Welcome back. Keep coming back. So I'm thrilled that Steve mentioned the picture, because I picked it very deliberately, to reflect a concept that is taught in this book. And the invitation to wholeness, many of us here, as Connie said, are very interested in service in the world. From a Unity perspective, though, I think a lot of us come to service from this, everything's broken, we gotta fix it, even we're broken, we gotta fix it, as opposed to coming from our own wholeness. And to reinforce this idea that actually we create environments for healing for others, even people that we would normally be judgmental of, when we show up authentically in the world. I want to read two quotes to end this time from Parker Palmer. The first is this: is this person the same on the inside as he or she seems to be on the outside? Children ask this about their parents, students about their teachers, employees about their supervisors, patients about their physicians, and citizens about their political leaders. When the answer is yes, we relax, believing that we are in the presence of integrity and feeling secure enough to invest ourselves in the relationship and all that surrounds it. So when we are connected to home, aware of our true nature, and we therefore reflect that more purely in the world, and therefore bless the world by that sense of integrity. But the piece that I'll close with, that is so, that Steve actually touched on also, is the importance, actually the essential aspect of spiritual community in this endeavor. And Parker Palmer says, we cannot embrace this challenge all alone, at least not for long. We need trustworthy relationships, tenacious communities of support if we are to sustain the journey toward an undivided life. That journey has solitary passages, to be sure, and yet it is simply too arduous to take without the assistance of others. And because we have such a vast capacity for self-delusion, we will inevitably get lost en route without correctives from outside ourselves. Over the years, he says, my own need for community has led me to collaborate with others in creating settings where there is mutual encouragement for rejoining soul and role. And so that is my invitation to us. And if you didn't get a chance to share up here, I invite you to share during our potluck or come join us during the class. I feel like it is a core piece of my mission to create these sacred circles of trust that allow us to more fully embody in the outer, in the community realm, who we really are as a blessing not only to ourselves, but to the world.